First, you have some time to look at questions 1 to 5. Now we shall begin. You should answer the questions as you listen, because you will not hear the recording a second time. Listen carefully and answer questions 1 to 5.
Kingsbury College, can I help you?
Oh, hello. I'm ringing to find out about one of your courses.
Yes. Is that a daytime or an evening course?
Evening.
Right. I'll just get a few details from you, if I may.
Fine.
Could I have your full name, first of all?
It's Peter Wright. That's W-R-I-G-H-T.
OK. And I don't need to know your exact age, but can you tell me which of these age groups you belong to? 18 to 25, 26 to 35, 36 to 45, or over 45?
18 to 25.
Fine. And do you have a job, or are you a full-time student?
I'm an accountant. I just do courses in my spare time, for interest.
OK. Right. And your address, Mr. Wright?
It's 11 Forest Road.
F-O-R-E-S-T?
Yes.
Is that in Kingsbury?
Yes, it is. I'm just down the road here.
And do you have a phone number?
It's 992-471. That's my home number. I haven't got a work number.
That's fine. We probably won't need it.
Before you hear the rest of the conversation, you have some time to look at questions 6 to 10. Now listen and answer questions 6 to 10.
Now, you want to register for a course?
Yes, cookery.
Do you happen to know the exact title of the course? We've got Thai cookery on Wednesdays, or Mexican cookery on Fridays, or...
Mexican. I'd like to do both, but I'm busy on Wednesdays.
OK. Well, you can always do the other one next term, I suppose. Now, do you know when it begins?
Is it the 26th of March?
That's right. And it's £45 in total. That's including the ingredients. How would you like to pay? Card? Cash?
Can I send a cheque?
You can, yes. As long as it arrives at least 1 week before the start of the course.
OK.
And I'll just give you a reference number. If you could make a note of it and write it on the back.
Yes.
It's CZ943.
Yes, got that.
Good. Well, there's just one last question. Do you have any special requirements that I should make a note of?
Yes, there is one thing. I use a wheelchair.
Right, so you need to have access for that. Okay. Don't worry, your room is on the ground floor and I'll make sure there are no steps involved. We can always put a ramp in.
Thanks.
So, we look forward to seeing you on the 26th of March.
That is the end of part one.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now it turns to part two.
Part two.
You are going to hear a guide named Matt, who is introducing their trip in Wildlife Haven. Now you have some time to look at questions 11 to 15. Now listen to the first part of the introduction carefully and answer questions 11 to 15.
Well, good morning, everybody. My name's Matt, and I'm one of the three guides here at Wildlife Haven. Our job is to make sure that you all have a great time here with us and go home feeling happy and relaxed. As you can see, we're away from the city in a remote area between a national park and the sea. To encourage you to relax, there are no radios or TVs, and the only phones and newspapers are in the office. So, if peace and quiet is what you've come for, this is the place to be. From your cabin on the hill, you'll find you have the national park behind you, and you can look out from the sea from your front balcony. Your luggage will be unloaded from the bus and taken to your rooms in a few minutes. Once you have picked up your key at reception, please locate your room and check that all your luggage has arrived. The daily program here at Wildlife Haven is flexible and only as demanding as you want it to be. You should each have a brochure setting out the facilities and various walking tracks you can take. And on the bus, you are given a green sheet setting out a number of group tours in the coming week. If you want to join any tour, just write your name and room number on the relevant sheet along the wall here. Tomorrow, there is a beachcombers and rockhoppers tour exploring marine life in the rock pools along the beach. Or, if you'd prefer to go inland, there's a guided forest walk that takes you off the walking tracks. If you want to catch some lunch, you could join the beach fishing expedition. And at night, you'll see there is a moonlight forest walk that leaves each night at 7 p.m. So there is plenty to choose from at Wildlife Haven, and of course, that includes just sitting on your balcony watching the waves roll in. But I would recommend my favorite tour, the Waterfall Walk. This departs at sundown each day and also provides the opportunity to have a moonlight swim.
Now you have some time to look at questions 16 to 20. In the second part of the introduction, you are going to get some advice from Matt. Listen carefully and answer questions 16 to 20.
You've chosen to visit us in January, which is one of our hotter months. And although you may be tempted to wear a minimum of clothing, you should always take precautions against injury, particularly in the national park. This includes sensible footwear. You'd be surprised how many of our guests ignore this advice and end up being sorry. And socks are a good idea, too. And even though you might be under trees a lot of the time, it's a good idea to wear a hat in this hot climate. There's no need to be too concerned about walking in the national park, provided you use common sense. It's true that there are poisonous spiders in the park, but they are really more frightened of you than you are likely to be of them. I should also warn you against eating any wild berries. Some are edible, but you should avoid them all. We'll provide all the food you can eat. Well, that's about all for now. Dinner is from 6 to 8 p.m. in this building.
That is the end of part two.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now it turns to part three.
Part three.
You'll hear two university students discussing a social science lecture they attended. First, you have some time to look at questions 21 to 24. Now listen carefully and answer questions 21 to 24.
Did you go to the first social science lecture yesterday?
Yeah. Didn't you see me there?
No. I was trying so hard to understand the lecturer.
What didn't you understand?
A lot of it, really. For example, he said we needed to study history as part of the course, but I didn't get why.
You probably missed it. He said early on that we need to learn from our past mistakes.
Right. But he also said we need to put ourselves in the place of our ancestors. Why is that?
I think the point is that it's not enough to know how they lived and what they did. We need to know what they thought.
I see. And I've written transferable skills in my notes next, but I have no idea what that means.
If you study social science, you learn skills that you can use in a job.
Oh, right. Is that all? Okay, but why is that?
The point he made was that in studying social science, you use a flexible and adaptable approach to learning.
Before you hear the rest of the conversation, you have some time to look at questions 25 to 30. Now listen and answer questions 25 to 30.
He also kept mentioning all the other subjects we will need to study as part of the course. I didn't write them all down, did you?
Some of them. I think I can make sense of my notes. The first one was anthropology, which he said would cover prehistory and archaeology as well.
Okay.
Then there's economics. I wrote down that this was not meant to mean that we will spend all our time looking at economic theory, but more that we need to see how humans behave.
That's good. I don't think I could handle economic theory. He said something about education too, didn't he?
Yeah. He said we'll be looking at how cultural information is handed down from one generation to the next through teaching children.
He said we'd be focusing on geography, too, but I can't really remember which aspects, can you?
I noted it down, I think. Here we are, yes, particularly in relation to urban planning. It's law that I got confused about. I didn't understand why he linked that to economics.
I think he meant that laws affect the way wealth is distributed.
That makes sense. Now, what are the science wars?
Okay, I did get that. The science wars are about how social science collects information. In sociology and social work, and in social science generally, they can only study patterns of behavior and observe. If you compare that to the way scientists work in physics or chemistry, it's very different because they use specific experiments that can be tested and which give concrete answers. Social studies is often accused of being unscientific. That's all.
Okay. But it still looks like a good course, doesn't it? You don't have any regrets, do you?
None at all. I'm looking forward to it.
That is the end of part three.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now it turns to part four.
Part four.
In this section, you'll hear a lecture on coral reef. First, you have some time to read questions 31 to 40. Now listen carefully to the lecture and answer questions 31 to 40.
Do you fancy diving in the wonderful world of coral reefs, green sponges, colourful fish and red crabs? It is a rich garden beneath the waves. But how much do you know about the corals? Are they animals or plants? What are the threats to coral reefs? Today, Mr. Tim Harford, Executive Director of the Coral Reef Alliance, is going to introduce the facts about coral reefs.
Good afternoon, everyone. Coral reefs are one of nature's most magnificent creations. It is filled with thousands of unique and valuable plants and animals. Over one quarter of all marine species depend on healthy coral reefs. Humans also depend on coral reefs. These marine ecosystems are the primary source of food and income for millions of people, a vast repository of valuable chemical compounds and medicines, and a natural wave barrier that protect beaches and coastlines from waves and storms. Coral is actually the exoskeletons of coral polyps. Made from limestone, these skeletons build up over time, forming the reef. New corals are born each April. At a certain hour, on a certain night, mature corals suddenly release clouds of eggs and sperm into the sea. After the fertilized eggs take root on the seafloor, they can grow up to 15 centimeters per year. Coral reefs are present in the waters of over 100 countries. These are warm, 18 to 29 degrees centigrade, shallow, sunny regions primarily between the tropics of Cancer and Capricorn. Only clear, warm salt water can support a coral reef. And because sunlight is crucial to the reef's survival, the water must also be shallow. The algae that grow on coral provide much of the coral's food. In deeper water, algae cannot get the sunlight they need to grow. Most coral reefs are in the tropics because natural conditions there are perfect. In their modern form, coral reefs have thrived on Earth for over 50 million years. In recent years, however, more than 11% of the world's reefs have been lost, with another 16% severely damaged during the El Niño event in 1998. Up to 32% of coral reefs may be destroyed by human activities in the next 30 years if we do not take action now. Corals and coral reefs are extremely sensitive. Slight changes in the reef environment may have detrimental effects on the health of entire coral colonies. These changes may be due to a variety of factors. One of the greatest threats to coral reefs is human expansion or development. As human population increases, so does the harvest of resources from the sea. Due to overfishing, reef fish populations have been greatly decreased in some areas of the world. The removal of large numbers of reef fish has caused the coral reef ecosystems to become unbalanced. As we know, corals are also very popular as decorations. A large amount of the most healthy corals are selected by commercial collectors. They sell the corals to souvenir shops, where a large number of tourists wait to purchase them as decorations or souvenirs. Coral reefs also receive much damage from both commercial and private vessels. The leakage of fuels into the water and the occurrence of spills by large tankers are extremely damaging to local corals. Although much of the coral reef's degradation is directly blamed on human impact, there are several natural disturbances which cause significant damage to coral reefs. The most recognized of these events are hurricanes or typhoons, which bring powerful waves to the tropics.
These storm waves cause large corals to break apart and scatter fragments about the reefs. Home to a diverse community of creatures, coral reefs are underwater treasure chests of colour and activity. Predators and prey swim and crawl among the coral in nature's never-ending dance of life and death. This lively, fascinating world beneath the waves is just waiting to be explored.
That is the end of part 4.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.